We're back, baby. We're back.
All right, folks.
Sort of.
How was Botswana?
Botswana was hot.
Botswana?
Hot and dry. Now, I was actually in Europe where it was hot and moist as fuck, as you know, as you well know.
I noticed that. When I was in
Vienna, it was 36 degrees, man. It was not nice.
I was driving in 38, so I win.
Yeah, it's fucking horrible, isn't it? I went to a Barcelona game, right? And then the subway afterwards was literally one of the hottest places I've ever been in my life. Like, I came out and had to wring my t-shirt out. It was so covered in sweat.
That's disgusting.
Fucking horrible, man. Yeah.
It didn't rain in the part of France where we played in a festival for 4 weeks. And then the night the festival finished, the most otherworldly thunderstorm, I mean, just shit I've never seen before, swept basically everything right down the hillside. It was fucking wild. So
that's cool.
Yeah, very moist in a literal sense.
Well, I did get a thunderstorm in Venice, which was pretty cool. Especially just seeing the lightning. The lightning was like, the thunder was so far away that you'd see the lightning, and it'd be like a good 2 minutes before you actually heard the thunder. Mm-hmm. It was so fucking cool.
No, this was right on top of us. It was wild. It was good. Vicky, do you see any lightning while we were away?
There apparently was thunderstorms here as well, but I don't know. It kind of missed where I live. I went into work the next day and everyone's like, "Oh man, did you see that lightning last night?" And I was like, "No."
Yeah, when I came back on Sunday, it was quite a lot of lightning, thunder, lightning.
Here we are, just talking about the weather.
Yeah. I know, it's really...
It's a very British thing, isn't it?
it's really banal.
Sweet day, yeah, it's just awkward day.
Yeah.
Because we haven't seen each other in a while, there's a bit of that abandonment issue.
Sure.
Yeah, of course. Speaking of abandonment issues.
Abandonment.
I was thinking
right,
more
good.
I was thinking more that we could do with some more subscribers, but hey, you take it
no, that's true.
You take it in your direction if you want this.
How about more of you subscribe? How about that? How about that for an idea? In fact, I have just hooked up some amazing new records for the record club. Mm. It'd be really nice if more people were part of that to experience them, because there's some absolute belters on the way. There's some really good digital stuff on the way as well. Some ethical black metal, bit of that.
Had Antifa be, black metal.
I don't know if it's Antifa black metal, but it's certainly not pha.
Mm-hmm. So that's the main thing.
That's good enough.
Black metal has to assert now if it's ethical or not.
Yeah, just
that's
like white people.
Interesting, yeah. Exactly. Yeah, I was thinking that, yeah.
Vegan black metal that's not pagan
straight
black metal.
Straight people.
Aren't you pagan-esque, I guess, but not.
He's
not
an ethical cis white male. Yeah. anyway, before I go too far down the fucking Jordan Peterson route.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we've got some sick new records, and I mean sick in the cool kid way, because that's back. We've got some sick new records on the way, so please join the record club. You can do the digital one, where loads of the money goes to the bands, far, far, far more than if you listen to the record on Spotify, like a million times, you know, so that's one incentive. Or there's the vinyl club, where you get actual records in the post, proper stuff, sometimes limited runs, sometimes sort of rare and colour editions and stuff. And a load of money goes to the bands and the labels, and you get digital stuff, and you get all the perks of early episodes, bonus episodes, access to the AAA group, so you can influence the content of the episodes. It's really good. It's a little present to yourself. You can do an annual subscription if you're super flush, if you got a bonus or a tax rebate, or you can just dip in and out month at a time. If you join up, you want to try it for a month and see what you get, do that. There's no obligation. So yeah, getting about it, because we're doing a really good job, frankly, of sourcing some really, really good music. All the feedback from people who've got it has been positive so far, so there should just be more of you doing it. Be nice to yourself.
Yeah, and you can also dip in and dip out if you only want to do it for a month or two. That's totally fine. Shout out to Jordan Butler, our main man, who's been subscribing for a long, long time, decided to take a little break. But, you know, you can do that, and he let us know, and that's really nice. So if you want to do that as well, just give us a shout, and we can sort something out for you as well. That's, like, no problem. And also, a big thanks to Eric Freeman, who is a new sub for us. So,
hey, Eric.
Welcome, Eric. Hope you enjoy the Facebook group and the bonus episodes and all that fun stuff.
People certainly love that Facebook group. A lot of rich patter.
Rich.
Yeah.
A firm exchange of ideas. And teasing Kenny Bonilla. Okay.
Speaking of teasing,
this is another installment of Demolicious.
Actually, I had a thought the other day in the shower that we could have called it Demolition, because it's kind of what we do.
I think that's implied.
Yeah.
I think you're deconstructing the joke there.
Mm.
Is that what you do in the shower?
And my general existence. Yeah.
Smart.
Especially after being the Kafka Museum.
Yeah, we have three submissions. And first off, massive props to the people who are game for this. I mean,
yeah, totally.
Yeah, the Demolicious that we did with our own stuff was to try and, you know, put our money where our mouth was and say, hey, we can laugh at ourselves as well. And by the way, it's not all laughter, because some of the stuff's great, but not this one.
I gave her the game away already.
I'm just, you know, that's setting the tone. But no, I mean, it's a gamble, you know, and I think everybody's on the same page, because we all like to kind of laugh and cringe at our early demos, and there's good bits in there. There's good bits in there, even this month. But it's cool. It's fun.
I feel bad because I'm not in a band. I don't have a demo. There's no existing evidence of me playing Wonderwall in the high school talent show I was like 12 or something. Why? I played Wonderwall on the guitar and my pal sang it.
I didn't
know that. Yeah, so I mean, if you want to have a night out with me, you'll get plenty of evidence of me making a complete tit of myself, and maybe that'll, you know, even things up a bit. But in terms of putting my cards on the table with demos and things,
I do have the Christmas episode from last year.
Oh yeah, yeah. If you exactly, just, you know, go back to that and
get really meta and do an episode where we deconstruct an episode.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, try and guess what mental illnesses I have.
Like that sketch inside by Will Burnham when he's deconstructing this video and deconstructing, deconstructing, deconstructing this video. Like, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. So if you're brave enough to take part in this in future as well, send your demo to. Mark, what's the email address?
unsungpod@gmail.com.
Yeah, and try and title it something like Demolicious or something demo themed, so it's a bit easier for us to find it. But yeah, links, Dropbox to files, Google Drive, that's all fine. We'll work it out. It helps if you put the tracks in order, because I've noticed that sometimes we're just getting files and apparently we're not doing them in the correct order. We also only ask that you send stuff that's like your earliest ideally demo. Don't be fucking
you're not trying to be cool here.
Yeah, don't be picking out things that you're actually secretly quite proud of. We're not into that. This is about sharing. This is about trust and vulnerability. All right. You know that team building exercise where you close your eyes and
trustful.
You fall backwards into the arms of your colleagues or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, imagine the colleague is our podcast, and imagine the floor is rejection. And imagine we catch you, but then we also drop you for a laugh.
Then we gently place you on the floor. Yeah.
And imagine before you fell, we actually secretly took a shit on the floor where you were going to fall as well. And then imagine we filmed it, and imagine we then posted that online. It's cyberbullying, but it's entertaining, and that's what's most important.
Definitely. I think we should put a wee disclaimer in here and say, like, these are people's, like, teenage demos or, like, early career demos.
We're laughing at young people.
But they're all adults now. I mean, yeah. We're not so brutal so that solid. We would actually be reviewing current high school teenagers' demos.
It's like people that engage in paedophilia by only having sex with adults because they used to be kids.
Is it? Is it like that?
It's exactly like that. Exactly like that.
Sending us a demo is a bit like playing Russian roulette.
Uh-oh. Is that a link?
That's a link.
It's a segue, isn't it?
A segue.
Okay, so are we a podcast for recovering metalheads?
Always.
Yeah, I know. I got that vibe, but I was really struggling.
With the record club as well, there's a disproportionate number of metalheads on the record club. And we got some awesome records of other genres, but we're definitely constantly having to bias it towards metal. The demos this month definitely suggest this.
See, you say metal, I say more recovering people who are really into Funeral for a Friend.
Yeah, so the three demos for this episode, as you can probably guess, encapsulate the broad and glorious traditions of metal, from, I would say, slightly Glassjaw-infused death metal to slightly death metal-infused Glassjaw. There's a bit of tippy-tappy emo contingent in there, there's some fucking humming patter that we'll get to. But I think we should start with, based on Mark's segue earlier, with the bold Greg Love, a long-time listener, a name we recognise, and his seminal outfit, Eyesore. Which, by the way, is only one letter away from Eeyore.
I noticed that. I did almost write it down as Eeyore, which is.
As names go, it's not the worst eyesore. It's also a demo with a name which you don't always get. Bullet points.
Oh, bullet points.
I can only imagine that the artwork almost definitely had some play on bullets if it had artwork.
And I think you're being generous by thinking it had artwork.
You never know, you know. Like, then the opening track, which Mark hinted at, Russian Roulette, continues that theme. So I would say...
Wait, I think you're out of order.
Am I out of order? Yes, so there we go.
Straight away.
All right, okay, well.
Starts with Mark's at 10.
Max out of 10, right? Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's got a track called Russian Roulette, and that continues the theme. So we're off to, I would say, an edgy and self-assured start. They've got thematic continuity.
Actually, it's called Max out of 10 for originality.
Oh, okay. Maybe I didn't put in the full name. Apparently, I was bored halfway through.
Which is brave, I think, as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's totally of that era, of the, which is very much from that Alexisonfire, early Thrice, sort of Glassjaw thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what you do. Like, Funeral for a Friend would do it. And it sounds a bit like early Funeral for a Friend as well.
The band doesn't have a Wikipedia, surprisingly.
Wonder why.
I mean, some of these have pages. I don't know if you've ever fucked with that. But yes, so Mark's out of 10 for originality. Mm-hmm. Starts with a heart monitor going flat, maybe because of a bullet. What do we think?
I guess so.
Yeah.
This is kind of riffy. This is one of those, we had this when we did your demo, Mark, no offence, one of those songs, those teenage kind of songs where like 95% of the vocal notes are the same note.
Yeah, I mean, the singer really, I can't hold a tune, but he sounds like the singer from Autumn to Ashes or something like that. The singer from Autumn to Ashes or something like that.
Yeah, there's a lot of froms.
Yeah, there's a lot of froms in there, yeah. I mean, it's got that line six or like Marshall MG dirty tone, which is just pure humming on the guitars. It's simple, but a lot of bands were doing this, including myself, in the mid-2000s.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there's a double vocal harmony thing in it, which
I've written that.
All right.
That's harmonies, exclamation point. Whoa, exclamation point.
Actually, in the second verse, they did a nice wee kind of second guitar line, which I thought was pretty effective. Mm-hmm. Guitar bridge in the middle eight.
That wee bit, and then the kind of fuzzy guitar comes in over the top.
There's like rhythmic chugs underneath it as it ramps up. I don't think that's mind-blowing, but it's a pretty nice idea for a first demo. By 4 minutes as well, this track kind of commits to that 4-4 kind of trundling beat, which I actually thought gave the last section of the song a bit of a lift. It's that kind of separate ending of a song was something I loved doing with songs, which was to just, instead of just go back into chorus, just change the end part of the song into something else. Interpol used to do that to quite good effect as well. They'd have like an outro of 2 minutes or so. So I quite like what they did at the end of this one, actually. They have the guitars start to have fun because the beat has leveled out and they weave around in it. I actually thought it was pretty decent. You know, it's not exactly, it's like it's 3 out of 10 marks for originality to go refer to the title. It's simple, but you know, in this case I would say simple's pretty good.
I think if for me it really very much, I guess it's because I can remember being in a band like this way back at the time, even though I was just jamming about in studios and stuff. But you can tell there's a bunch of guys, I'm going to say guys because it's unlikely there's going to be a woman in these kind of bands at this time, who are clearly like trying, playing at the very edge of their ability. and trying to push past that. And I found this quite, this whole demo quite endearing as a result of that.
Yeah.
You know, because maybe because I can imagine I was there as well.
I can imagine you playing some of this.
You know, mm-hmm. Yeah. I totally would have played. I played exactly stuff like this way back when, man. And so many bands in Glasgow that, as I'm no doubt sure that you've both seen at some point in your lives, you know. We'll go through the rest of it.
Yeah, what's the next track since my ordering's all wrong?
I've got Death of an Enemy.
Death of an Enemy. Yeah, uh-huh. So, who has an enemy in their teens, like a nemesis? It reminds me of that monobrowed baby sketch in The Simpsons, you know, like, mm-hmm. who has an mm-hmm. enemy at that age? This tune is named and kicks off like an early demo to me. This sounds like an
is
early
that
demo.
A very fast-paced one?
Mm-hmm. Well harmonised vocal.
Yeah.
Say they've done quite a good job of that.
Definitely. It sounds like Alexisonfire to me. In fact, it almost has the same production as Alexisonfire as well. And I like that band.
The wee flurries that break up the lines of the verse are quite interesting. It sounds a bit to me as well like a tune that somebody wrote early on, but then it stuck around and it gradually got modified. You know, our group had that as well. You know, songs that you perhaps should have ditched, but you get a wee bit attached to them, and so instead of ditching them, you decide that you're going to give it a rewrite and a rewrite. There was a song that DRA wrote, and it was basically because we were so pissed off at the fact that Biffy Clyro were doing so well. What was it called again? I mean, I can hear it in my head. Anyway,
I don't know.
But anyway, so we tried to rewrite it before we went to the States, and it was fucking ridiculous. Like it ended up sounding like a fucking prog version of Weezer, and it was that thing where you realise that some songs just need to be ditched. This song sounds to me like a song that the band have rewritten a bit, and probably wasn't strong enough in the first place and should probably have just passed, but you feel sentimental about it.
I think it does sound quite disjointed, especially when it jumps from the quiet to the loud, so I do agree with your comments there. The screams are not fun. they are not fun screams. There's a guitar bit around 2 minutes 20 which sounds exactly like an Alexisonfire riff. In fact, I actually think this may be an Alexisonfire song. I certainly did that. I rewrote one of them as well when I was a wee guy, and we did do that in a Demolicious episode, the first one. So I'm not being...
You're taking as good as you can give.
I'm not being uncharitable here.
Yeah.
I think there's a charm though, like I said, there's some ideas and they're reaching for something, but it does sound quite disjointed. And the dueling guitars at the end is pretty cool. A lot of bands were doing that back then, but it feels as though they were trying to do something that they couldn't quite do yet, like technically.
Yeah, you know? What's next?
IKYWU.
So I took a few runs at this. I know
guessing
you,
what it means.
I know you wear underpants.
Mm. Mm-hmm. In Kenya, young widows undress.
Iran killed Yoko with uranium.
I'll kill you with udders.
Incredible knowledge you wouldn't understand.
That's good.
It's a lot more metal. Mark, what is this? Is this
Galax? This is a 7-fold. Is what this is.
Galloping emo.
It's a 7-fold all over, man. It's one of the things I find quite interesting about this is you can totally tell it's a demo because the timing is all over the place. Like it speeds up and slows down, and it's, you know, it's floating, which I've written here is quite cute because I think it is quite cute. There's a single guitar on the left channel which is all over the shop, man. Like it's way, like it's out of time with the drums and not in a good way.
I love a wee bit of that.
And see that tom sound it's an affront to my ears, man.
It's a funky Tom sound.
It sounds
funky,
like somebody's slapping a fish in a bongo.
Oh my god, I said it sounds like a bum being scalped. I actually texted you and I was like, that kick drum's doing my back.
Well, this
in.
Is the toms as well.
All right.
Like, oh, no, but
the whole kit is like not great to be fair.
No, this kick drum thing's going to come up again, actually. That's interesting because that is a consistent theme. I would actually say even more so with the next two. But
I think this is something I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that this was probably recorded in a studio by an engineer who had never heard this kind of music before and was just doing the best he could.
You get a lot of that with demos. Engineers who grew up listening to fucking
Pink Floyd
or Squeeze and then they get confronted by a metalcore band and it's just like a really weird combination. Sometimes it works though. I mean, it's a pound shop version of like when Steve Albini recorded Neurosis. Do you know what I mean? It's like, what? They're working together? Well, maybe that'll be interesting. And, you know, sometimes it is. This isn't a great tune. I do think actually this record gets a bit better though, given that I don't know what the next song is, but the next two are better.
I need to say that at this point, when I was going through it, I was like, the vocal really reminds me of somebody and I couldn't put my finger on who. And then I did. It's Ian Watkins for Lost Prophets.
Oh, that guy.
That's what the vocal.
I wonder what he's up to now.
Yeah.
Still doing music.
Well, yeah, still doing music.
I bet you somebody's playing his bum like a bongo.
Oh!
Yep, what's next? What song?
Russian Roulette.
Russian Roulette. It's kind of punky. Is this emo metal? Mark, you listen to shite. What is it?
I don't know. It's not an apple, mate, so I wouldn't be able to tell you.
I thought there was it was quite emo at times. Even like the lyrics,
it is very emo.
And the last one where things like the end is near, there's got to be some reason for this and stuff. I got to a point where I'm like, what am I going to be able to say about these songs, because I don't understand this music at all. And so then I was just scraping about trying to see if I could figure out any of the lyrics.
Textual analysis. The guitars are a bit dank and fuzzy in this recording. I think it's not the clarity that genre usually goes for. I'm pretty sure this wasn't a big budget recording. It's like you say, you get an engineer that maybe isn't massively familiar with the genre, so it's kind of got a lot of low end. I don't really think these bands usually have on those guitars. They're usually a bit more, there's a bit more clarity.
It was at this point I started to realise that I've written here, I'll bless the drummer's wee heart. He's doing his level best to try and do the things that his, like, I guess the people that he likes do, I guess heroes if you want to call them that, but he can't quite do it. I'm sure he probably nailed it at some point in his band's career, and if he's still drumming now, I'm pretty sure he's probably fucking awesome.
Yeah, probably good.
You know, this gave me Thrice vibes, like early Thrice, like Teen Seer, Phoenix Ignition sort of thing. There's a wee bit at 2 minutes 33 when it does like a wee breakdown and it goes fast. A lot of bands at that time did that, particularly Thrice. I mean, they moved away from that sound really quickly because they were wee guys when they started out as well. And then it ends with a gunshot, which is dead edgy.
Hey, there we go, thematic. And talking about consistency, I really struggled to tell the last song bullet points from some of the other songs. I had to kind of like rewind to work out that it wasn't a continuation or another song and repeat.
I actually thought the last song was maybe the most catchy.
Yeah, no, I think it's actually,
I think I listened to it twice and I can hear it, like I know how it goes. Do you know, you know what I mean? It's quite memorable.
That lead vocal is Funeral for a Friend. That's why it's so catchy, because it sounds like a funeral vocal and a funeral hook as well.
It's got the harmonised intro, and that kind of thing reappears throughout. That's one a bit more in the metal the emo metal sort of territory for me.
Yeah, yeah, you've got that voice, that
that little Iron Maiden guitar nod thing.
Feel for offended that as well.
So. Yeah, I mean, Mark, I could imagine you playing this one in particular. That there's some gain on the vocals, then it's trade with that sweeter sung line. Probably not the same person singing the two parts, I would imagine. Mm. Or if it was, then that would be a shift live to go between that. You'd be gassing out pretty early. The talking about textual analysis, the so-called
refrain. I know, that goes on forever, man.
Oh, fuck me. That is the sort of overwrought self-pity we've been waiting for. And it is like a heady nostalgic whiff in my own, you know, teenage uh-huh. solipsism, you know, just
That's the word for it, I think. At the beginning there's just this, or like near the beginning there's this wee bit, and it sounds like there's like a guitar versus drum call and response thing happening, which I thought was an interesting idea, but I think the drums, they're maybe not as tight as they could be as well.
It could also just be one take. They could maybe have just done it in one take as well, you know.
I have to say, I don't think this is as bad as, I mean, it's actually pretty decent. And if indeed Greg has been honest and this was their first demo, then kudos to them.
Yeah.
I would say that the first Dead in American demo by comparison sounds like a bus full of special kids and microphones rolling down a cliff. So it's really pretty together. They knew what they wanted to sound like. It's got exactly. like a consistency of sound. We, for example, definitely did not. We had about 7 different styles of music on that first demo alone. And they take a pretty good stab at it. And while it's, I think it's totally indistinguishable from about a billion bands that came out across a sort of 15-year period. You know, the little dude guys that you'd see in the front steps, you know, the Gallery of Modern Art in Glasgow on a Saturday. It's totally passable, and it's respectable, and it makes me feel a bit self-conscious about how bad my own was. But well done, Greg. That's actually pretty decent.
Yeah, I mean, I've written here, I actually think this band could have done something if they stuck at it, you know, in that era, you know. Yeah. There's almost catchy vocals here and there. There's some riffs that work, even though they're derivative. And the players actually had a sense, like you say, Chris, had a sense of what they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And they had they all had a goal they're working towards together, I think. And maybe there's more releases by this band where this becomes more fully realised. And I would actually listen to that, because I think that'd be quite interesting.
I wouldn't. No offence.
I think it'd be interesting to see like how much better they got, you know. I think
that would be interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They would have to come up with some ideas though. Because otherwise there's a big fucking emo landfill.
Absolutely. I mean, don't get me wrong, I do think it is very derivative of the era, but there's so many other bands that were not as good and were signed. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And I think these guys, if they stuck at it, they could have got there, I think.
Mm. I think it's okay that they're derivative. I think if it's that part time in your development and you're just trying things out, then that's kind of enough, isn't it? Like, just having the guts to try different things. Like,
even bands that have different sounds, almost all those sounds are taken from somewhere. Mm-hmm. And you, it's almost unavoidable that you're derivative right at the start.
Because you're still practicing. I mean, you practice forever, right? But that's just part of the evolution of that.
So can I suggest that we tackle Ator next?
Sure.
Sure, yeah.
Ator, courtesy of Thomas Smart. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Thomas. Thanks for sending that in. Mm-hmm. Now, Thomas only sent in one track.
I saw that, yeah.
Right. However, if you have a wee rummage around, you can go back into the SoundCloud page and there's a shitload of other stuff there. So it could well be that this is the Peterborough sound that everyone talks about. This band hails from Peterborough. I mean, Thomas was being a little selective maybe in sending this one tune.
But it's his demo, isn't it? So maybe the other ones aren't demos.
Yeah, but it's called Song 3 and we specifically said send your first demos.
Right.
If you're only going to send one tune and you send Song 3, you're asking for me to go rummaging about in your back catalogue. Mm-hmm. No innuendo intended. this tune is by far the heaviest, even on this month of metal.
Yeah, the vocals are brave.
Brave's an interesting word. As a bit of a backstory, Thomas did point out that the band were mostly around 14 years old, but had a 23-year-old singer, who I think was called Dan, unless Dan came in later. But I'm sorry, but for today, the vocalist is getting called Dan Vox. So Dan Vox, why were you getting into bands, you little dude? Is Peterborough a metal vacuum? Were these like the only other moshers in town?
Probably.
You know, we moshers know that moment in a small town, you know, when your eyes meet across a shopping centre. Mm-hmm. You're like, me and you, one day we're going to have a metal band. So a bunch of 14-year-old little dudes and a 23-year-old singer doing some death metal-y stuff. Mm-hmm. The wee dudes in this do pretty well.
Yeah.
And the vocals are pretty full-throated. We talk about song three, the one that he submitted itself. I mean, it starts and immediately goes into a slowdown, although I'm not sure that was intentional.
I know.
It was programmed drums, so it must have been intentional to some degree.
Well, something slows down by a good few BPM in the first 20 seconds.
Yeah.
And it doesn't sound like it's on purpose. By 3 minutes, the singer kind of turns into a croon. And I think at that point, actually, it's the little dudes in the band who are doing a lot of the carrying of the song, because the singing in the crooning stage is not working. Dan Vox starts flinging out various styles. There's notes to Glassjaw, then he slips back into like the death metal thing.
Mm-hmm.
Vicky, you're not a metal fan. What did you think of this?
I thought the vocals really reminded me of someone, and I was trying to wreck my brain as to what it was.
Try to wreck your brain.
I'll say that again. I was trying to rack my brain to think who it was, and I spent ages, like, I came down to it's like either Shredder from the Turtles or Tony Todd, who's Candyman, or what was the other one?
I have the answer. It's Cookie Monster.
Oh, yes! There you go. It's Cookie Monster. Right. It's Cookie Monster, it is, actually. Yeah, it is. That's perfect.
So this is one of the ones with the bum slap kick drum. And this is the thing, is we've talked about this quite a bit in the past when we've done metal albums. So like those slappy kick sounds are so predominant in metal, because metal, especially with the kind of rhythmic and double speed and, you know, all the things that are going on in the kick drum, they want it to be really, really clear. They often use triggers so that you'll actually have a little contact mic, so it won't just be the sound of the drum you're hearing, it'll be a wee electronic thing to make it extra clicky. It's called click. And sometimes they just give up altogether, and or it seems like they give up in the low end of the kick drum, and it just becomes like a like this, and that can get pretty grating.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when the low end of it drops out. There's a fair bit of this. It's to give metal definition. It definitely doesn't sit well with people who are not used to it.
I didn't hate it, actually. I thought it was all right.
I mean, this band clearly didn't have a drummer at this point, because it is all electronic drums, right? This is very much a demo. You know, you get a demo, which is like your first recording as a band, and you get the demo before the demo, where you're chucking about ideas and send it to like people.
How do you know it's programmed drums?
Because it sounds really programmed.
Right.
Like, it's perfect. It's quantized perfectly. You can hear it. It doesn't sound real. It sounds robotic.
In that case, at the start, that drift must be the guitar riff going out of time then, because there's definitely a lag at the start.
Mm-hmm.
What's interesting is that this isn't even the first version of this song by this band, because there's a version of it without vocals. If you go and look at the very, very bottom of their SoundCloud. So how do we scout about on some of their other tunes? They fuck around with various styles, and the recordings vary quite a bit as well, with some quite deep and growly stuff and some others that are really scooped and almost like tech metal, you know, very thin guitars. There's a tune called River's Edge, which experiments with a vocal where I don't know if it's still Dan Vox, but Dan Vox sounds like he's miles back for the mic, and it actually works really well on that song. It's not the whole song, but just that bit. It was like, I kind of looked up, I was like, oh fuck, that's actually really clicking there. My blood. That tune also seems to have a few sequenced double kick trills in it, like some sort of kind of tech metal electronic hybrid thing. Another track called Forever Fake goes in a totally different vocal direction. And one called A Thousand Damaged, which I think looks close to being their earliest recording, is actually pretty brutal. You know, the style of it is pretty thunderous and relentless. We guys in Peterborough really like to riff, apparently. I'm curious what they do these days. As a band and as individual musicians, I'd imagine by now. It's interesting to be able to hear a band looking about for their niche. Mm-hmm. You know, they know roughly where they want to be, but they're trying to find what works. And listening through those tracks in the SoundCloud, you can see them dabbling with different bits and bobs to see where it's going to take. And so it's quite different to Eyesore in that sense, because they had a sound. If that is their first demo, it's like, this is what we want to sound like. And the demo's pretty consistent throughout, with little bits of variation. These guys seem to vary quite a bit. I think that, I will say, the highlight of the Ator SoundCloud is a track called Ator Instrumental Intro Track. Right, so this is a band that must have had an instrumental intro either to herald them on stage, or maybe they played it at the start of the set. It has this totally barmy synth sound in it that's like a cello setting on a bit tempi, and it's exactly the kind of goofy sort of dweebish thing that I would have done as well, where you think that it sounds dramatic and it just sounds fucking ridiculous. So that was a personal takeaway. But again, it's not too bad. I mean, I doubt very much they're still a going concern.
Yeah, I mean, my thoughts on song three was the only one I listened to. They sound like a cross between the Black Dahlia Murder and Glassjaw to me. That one song does anyway. I actually wonder if the singer had actually written the demo and like asked the boys to play it, because they were boys, let's not fuck about, right? They were boys, 14-year-old boys. Like, sometimes that could happen. Sometimes that happens, you know.
The boys wrote the demo and asked to sing it.
That's also possible, yeah, you know what I mean? So I did wonder, though, like, that question to pop up in my head, like, is this an older guy writing music and just needs somebody to play it, and he can't find any other current computer but that wants to play his weird brand of post-hardcore and fucking black metal, you know what I mean? Or as it sounds, it's just a bunch of guys trying to find what they really want to do, exploring the different kinds of heaviness that they want to, that they like, and figuring out which one fits best for them.
The thing is, you know for a fact that somewhere in Peterborough there's like an old like Bathory fan, a guy in his like late 50s, early 60s, who would have joined the band. That would have been amazing to have like maybe 3 14-year-olds, 1 23-year-old, and then a 60-year-old at the back. That's what you want to see when you go to a little town.
Gandalf and the, what do you call them? What are the wee people in Lord of the Rings called?
Hobbits.
Gandalf and the Hobbits.
There's a lyric at the end which I think is something like, you're just a fucking slut, I wouldn't shit on you, which is very, very interesting indeed.
Is that like a Rorschach test, like where it was just like,
no, it's like,
and that's what you heard.
It's sung. It's a sung vocal. It's like Glassjaw.
It does not pass the Bechdel test.
Pure Glassjaw.
It's pure Glassjaw. It's, Glassjaw. It's very true to the origin. Then, yeah.
What was the
lyric again?
It's like, you're just a fucking slut. I wouldn't shit on you if then something afterwards I just couldn't make out. And it's sung at Glassjaw, and it is pure everything you ever wanted to know about Silence era Glassjaw. It's straight out of that fucking playbook, man. And I was like, mate, these boys are 14, you're 23. Rein it in, for fuck's sake.
Maybe they wrote it.
Maybe, that's also possible. Yeah.
He's like, guys, do I need to sing this?
Like, yes, sing it! I feel awkward.
Guys, I shouldn't be saying this.
Dad, you fucking sir. We're not going to play your song. Fucking say it now, I'll stab you in the fucking neck.
sing it. He's always saying things like that.
Oh my God.
So this brings me to what's definitely going to be the personal highlight of the week.
And like the difference in quality in demos is quite different, don't you think? Like this,
but you mean sonically or musically?
Like I feel like this one's a lot louder.
It's louder. It sounds like ISO to me. It's the exact same kind of band.
Well, we're talking about Stoma.
Yeah, Stoma. Mm-hmm.
By the Bold, the Crag.
What did he do in this band?
He played guitar and would kind of bark up at the microphone. Yeah. Like, he had this weird posture, like a little goth frog. Crag was very good at being a pointy guitar metal dude. He fucking nailed that. Yeah. He had a brutal fringe, an absolutely brutal fringe, and he had the look just totally nailed. He took that kind of squat position when he was playing and just like, yeah, really went for it. So these guys were sort of contemporaries of mine. And in the same way as
we vibed.
Well, you can both be friends and kind of hate another band at the same time. I think we're all very familiar with that. I'm sure our band and our Nirvanisms got many a ribbon. So this was an interesting proposition for me to go back and listen to, because I will say I don't have particularly favourable recollections of the band. We played a couple of quite good shows together, but the styles didn't really match. And yeah, the audiences back then didn't, I mean, you don't get much choice when you come from Stirling, but the audiences didn't necessarily blend awfully well as well. That said, straight off the bat, this is actually a lot better than I remember. And I think my recollections are coloured by both the kind of awkwardness of being stupid wee dudes and rivalries and stuff, but also their antics, because they were very much an antics band, and I think Crag will quite happily acknowledge that. They had the look, they had the haircuts, they had the moves. You remember there was that era of fucking this kind of music where certain guitar sounds were accompanied by a certain guitar move, like a point or a swing, or a, you know, like or a certain kind of stomp. It wasn't quite crab dance era, but you know, they
it was almost that.
It was getting there,
the precursor.
So I think I found that a little bit alienating, since I was a fucking like flannel wearing shoegaze and knob end. Speaking of mine. But yeah, so is Zoning track one?
Yes,
it is.
That's correct.
That's good, you got that one right.
Did you notice that it's got a different title? The band's got a different name on the demo.
What are they called in the demo?
Monkey a Law, I think it is.
Yes, it does. It says something like that.
Monkey at what?
A Law.
A Law?
Uh-huh. Is it a Law? Allow something like that.
A Lore or something,
yeah.
I don't know.
It's not Stoma anyway.
Fucking
kind of weird.
Don't remember that.
Maybe they changed their name before you came in contact.
No, no, they wouldn't have. I just maybe blocked it out. It's ambitious for an opening song. It's got a long kind of emotional guy intro with harmonics and clean guitar.
Guitars sound good. I think what makes things like this hard for me is, with this type of music, what I find off-putting or hard to kind of like stick with it, is that it gets to a point where I feel like everybody, like all the vocals are all singing like two or three different songs.
These guys do that a lot.
Yeah, that's a definitely, you know, that's a feature. Is that a bug or a feature?
There's a point in this where it sounds like Glassjaw, Obituary and Converge are all singing at the same time.
Pretty much, man, yeah. Pretty much.
It's hard for me to sustain my attention with that a wee bit.
Again,
it's post-hardcore for the early mid-2000s. Exactly what it is.
Yeah, man. I mean, you know? I remember the early stuff Crag did being a little bit more metal, and then Glassjaw hit, or I seem to remember them being into more conventionally metal stuff, and then Glassjaw happened, and suddenly this is fucking dripping with Glassjaw. They were really, really fascinated by them.
Yeah.
again, I think you said that in the past.
It's interesting because I think there's some guitar bits in this that are like really early Converge as well, which may be coming for him, but it does overall go towards Glassjaw. And as I guess, yeah, it's, yeah, mostly Glassjaw, to be honest.
The live show, as I said, had a lot of gurns. You know, it had a lot of gurning. And there's a lot of gurning in the vocals, but I guess that's inherent with emo stuff.
But they, like, were they quite earnest, or were they like ripping the piss out themselves?
No, they were. I think they were pretty earnest. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are kind of light-hearted little in-jokes in the lyrics. We'll get to one of them. But
I think the fact they're called Stoma as well is like...
Yeah, which I believe is a colostomy bag,
that's
right?
Correct.
Full of shit.
That's exactly it.
But they were pretty earnest on stage. As I said, they had their metal moves down and they had mm-hmm. a look. And I think a lot of our crowd were kind of anti-look. That seemed a bit passé. But then again, they got a lot more girls than we did. So fair enough.
Because they had the look, and that was what, that's exactly what was the girls liked at that time in Glasgow, apparently.
3 minutes 30, 35-ish gets kind of chuggy, and mm-hmm. I think it's a little bit sloppy at that point. The first 3 minutes this are actually pretty tight. There's some death metal vocal moments.
There's a good trade-off with the vocals on it as well, and the drummer seems to be like he's really on it, which is kind of cool.
I think around 4 minutes, it's a little messy again, but mm-hmm. it's kind of within acceptable mm-hmm. parameters for mm-hmm. a demo. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure that vocal at 440, I think he's saying can never, I think that's Crag. I actually think I can remember him doing that bit from the times we played together. There's a lot of extra vowels on this record, right? And it's a very Glassjaw thing, right? But there's like, nay, hey, hey, hey.
That's, yeah.
Like, there's a lot of that. A lot of, like, stretching. There's one later on, way, yeah.
That is very Glassjaw indeed, yes. I've got so much of this in there.
I don't know where this was recorded, right? But it sounds too decent to have been anywhere in Stirling at the time, because Stirling was not spoiled for choices, and it does sound too together.
What was it? There was that wee record recording studio down there.
There was Pulse and Davey, and we were all kind of friends with Davey, but this doesn't sound like one of Davey's recordings. He didn't handle the chug particularly well, and it's definitely not Random Rhythms, which, as you'll probably remember, was a converted public toilet and sounded like it as well.
Vaguely.
Mm-hmm. So no, I mean, the sound of this is half decent.
Yeah, the one thing I found the production really trebly. It actually made my ears hurt in places.
It's the clarity though that the Eyesore could probably benefit.
Absolutely, I can imagine this being the next evolution of Eyesore, to be honest.
Earsore.
The thing that kind of that really kind of made me go what? And this song was, there's a beat down in the outro, but it almost sounds like one guitar's playing it. Even though I know they've got two guitar players, I was like, what the fuck's, what's that guitar doing?
So they're either so locked in, or
it sounds exactly the
maybe
same.
The other guitar was playing a riff for Doug's.
Yeah, maybe. But it just sounds purely like, bizarre. What the fuck are you doing?
That was still my secret. It appealed also to Doug's.
It's multi-species.
It's track two, Chemical Gimmick.
Chemical Gimmick, yep.
Right. Hyper Glassjaw, shameless fucking Glassjaw.
The guitar's really loud. It's really loud.
The chorus in this one is a bit more post-hardcore-y. It's got 146, they've got their death metal monster voice. This is the one where, like, the mm-hmm. three bands playing at the one time, and I can imagine it was pretty hard going. I think the breakdown has a similar style of guitar motif as the previous tune that sort of tries the same trick twice.
Is the breakdown the bit at 3.5 minutes that goes on for 50 seconds?
No, that's the beatdown.
Right, okay.
That's
the beatdown. We'll get to that.
The beatdown.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. 3:30 onwards, there's this beatdown thing.
Oh my God.
I will say, the beatdown goes on so long in this that it almost becomes arty. Like, you know, a lot of beatdowns would do a certain thing and then stop. And this one takes it just a little bit further. And I actually kind of like that.
It's like 50 seconds or something like that. And again, you're a fan of doing those wee bits as well, where like everybody stops and comes in and stuff like that. But I felt it just did not need to be there. Didn't need to be 50 seconds long.
But honestly, to get the pit moving, they loved it.
I know. See, that's the thing. It's quite
windmills.
These things might work differently live. I felt like it was a lot of dead air.
I mean, see, when that beatdown's happening, this is when the guitars are flying all over the place and the fringes are not moving because they've got so much gel on them. But you know, and then it kicks back into Glassjaw. It's also got a superfluous 10 seconds of dead space at the end of it, which is a beauty of a true demo. Badly indeed.
The beatdown's got a nice little discordant riff in it, which I liked. But I actually got angry at the vocal on this song because it was just so grating and so annoying. I actually got halfway through it and I was like, gonna just shut the fuck up, mate. I actually said out loud, I was gonna just shut the fuck up, mate.
it
hurt.
It's a bit much. Track 3, Kaizen.
Which is Japanese for good change.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. Or improvement, yes.
Oh, right. Oh. Okay, well, it's ironic then because this is fucking awful.
It's got that open, slow, melodic intro, which is it's very much of the era. It's very by the numbers. And then it becomes literally a bad Funeral for a Friend song.
I mean, it's got that strummy high school intro as well, you know. You back?
And I'm back.
Hey.
That strummy high school intro, I mean, that is like high school talent show intro, right? Fucking bit at the start. And then I think actually from 30 seconds it's trying to be Finch. It's trying to do the big anthemic thing when it kicks in.
It's a good shout, man. It's a good shout, actually.
Also, here's a bit of insight, right? I think it's about 58 seconds when you first hear someone shout full sex.
Yes, I thought that.
Right? Full sex, and then it recurs, like it's like a gag for the band, like the band loved this, right? I remember in Stirling, this fucking graffiti kept popping up around town, full sex, and we were like, what the fuck is this pish? Full sex, and we did a bit of graffiti in ourselves as well, shock horror, but it turns out it was an in-joke with Stoma, and this was just something that I think Crag wrote into this song, and then it became like a gag that would put up around town. So now it makes a lot more sense. This is one of those moments where a band has in patter. Crag's had a bit of that in his time.
Yeah,
a bit of in patter. It's odd. I mean, I can hear the wee guy humour on it, but fuck me, man, it's alienating. I think this tune, really, given that the first two tunes are actually passable you know, the first one's actually not that bad. This explains some of my negative recollections, because I do remember this song. I really didn't like this song. There's just waves of overlapping whinging in this song. Mm-hmm. The drums are solid, although like throughout, I think the drums are pretty well done, and the vocals are good at doing what they did, but what they were doing was fucking horrible. Mm-hmm. So it's that thing, you're good at doing a very derivative bad thing that did not age well. You know, a lot, some demos age better than others. This style of music didn't age particularly well, because those vocals were very, very of a moment and only of a moment. Mm-hmm. I think 3 minutes, it literally is just taken from a Glassjaw tune, that part. I also really started to notice the American accent that was on display. Mm-hmm. I don't know who did the Death Roars in Stoma. I think there was a guy in the band called Steven who was always a very serious looking dude, and I wonder if it was him. The twiddling riff bit in it isn't great. And the anthem ending again, the Finch ending, kind of fucking kills me a wee bit. Then it's got this fucking enormous fade out.
Was this the outro song? Was this like the last song they played?
Maybe it was There Smells Like Teen Spirit, I don't know.
It's got that vibe to it anyway. The beatdown at the end sounds like every other riff from every other beatdown that every other band ever did, ever.
Fucking Craig's thinking of doing here, eh? Just as well did he was made invited onto your one.
Did they have like a wee following of fans and stuff like that?
Yeah, aye. Mm-hmm. Like, as I said, we did a couple of shows together. We did a charity show together, and between us we actually pulled together a pretty respectable audience and raised some money for some stuff. So, but it was kind of burying the hatchet, I think, a wee bit at the time as well.
I think it's not too bad. Even with putting it alongside Eyesore, it's slightly better. I think the band could have done something in that era if they'd stuck at it and taken it a bit more seriously, you know. Even though there's a lot of bands that sound like it at the time,
they seem to me a bit more like they've got a band identity or something like that. And if they do have their like wee in patter or whatever, people that follow bands love shit like that, don't they? Like, yeah, that's the bit that kind of that unifies you and makes you be part of the gang, and that can be fun. Like, there's, I'm just thinking about other bands that have got that going on, and Take One for a Walk Week or something like that. Like, that's all true. That kind of like nonsense patter.
They had a very similar sense of in jokes.
There's that kind of thing that just kind of, it's endearing, or you enjoy it, you're part of the club.
Or alienating if you're not.
Or if you're not, you're like, what the fuck does Shagadog mean?
Shagadogaday. Very good. There you go. Again, kudos to all three of you for putting your neck on the line. Mm-hmm. Crack was shit in the bed about it. He was like, "You are going to be so cruel." And we were.
I don't think we were that bad. No. We could have been worse.
I don't know.
I think you were pretty fair-handed, Chris, as things go.
I mean, just apologies to everybody, because, like, I'm totally out of my depth here.
Just go back and listen to the Christmas special if you want to get your
exactly, revenge. If you feel like, you know, you want to get your revenge on me, yeah, go back and listen to the Christmas special.
Just, like, I wouldn't, what is it again? Shut up, you slut, I wouldn't shit on you.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Exactly, yes.
Sorry, shut up, you fucking slut. Can't forget that. That's very important.
Brilliant. What a note to end on.
Yeah. Surely, shut up, you fucking slut, I would shit on you. Because, like,
there's a word after, I wouldn't shit on you, and there's some other vocals.
If you were in fire or something,
yeah,
like
I couldn't,
that.
Yeah, couldn't make it.
Does not really put out fire. Unless there's a lawyer. Yeah. And at that point, she's probably going to drown anyway.
There are other vocals available.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm so cold.
So that's the end. That's the end of another episode of Demolicious.
Please send us some more. Yeah. This is fun.
Send us some more. Unsungpod at gmail.com.
Hey.
Almost
fucked it.
And put something to do with demos. Demolicious, ideally, in the title.
Yep.
And we will give it a bash. I mean, I'm not going to lie, we'll have fun doing it. And you might.
It'll make you a better person, you know, and it'll give you fortitude.
Yeah. Use us for catharsis. It's like confession. We're like the priest that tells you to go and do 50 Hail Marys and stop touching your mum.
We're not going to tell you to do that. I mean, that's optional, really.
Keep touching your mum.
Yeah, if you want, aye. It's between you and your ma, basically, what we're saying.
Catch you later.
Bye.
Bye.